Hello? All right.
Okay. So, welcome to Drupal 8 deployment and continuous integration. Today, I'll talk about continuous integration and why should you care about it at all. And I'll try to take a look about what do we have in Drupal 8 and what tools will help us there. So my name is Amin, and I'm the CTO at. I think I should stand here. I'm the CTO at Anlim. We're a Swiss-based company, and we do business-to-business mobile web solutions, and enterprise Drupal. We also recently launched something new, which is called Safe Swiss Cloud, and it provides developers with virtual data center capabilities. But I will talk a little bit about that later. So there's three things that I will cover in this talk. First is why should you care about continuous integration? The second thing is I'm going to share some of the tools and practices that we've used to achieve some of the goals that we had, and I will also review how Drupal 8 is going to help us and be a better tool for continuous integration. All right, so why do we bother with continuous integration at all? So how many of you are familiar with the situations here? Anybody? Just you? Okay. So we had this issue also in our company, and we had to spend like hours to prepare before we go live, and bringing configurations from all different, we have a distributed team, by the way, so we had to make sure that everybody, am I audible, no?
Use this one, since you're...
Okay. So we had to make sure that everybody puts the configuration into the right place, then we gather all that stuff, then we go and try to apply these configurations manually. Of course, it breaks all the time. And after we're done, most of the times we spend another week of fixing bugs that are related to the deployment itself. It's not like, not functional bugs, it's things that arise because we deployed this thing in not a very good way. So, and we had to deal with, so if anybody remembers a website that was so fragile and broken that, you know, every time you look at it, it basically breaks. We have a microphone issue. Yeah, this wasn't deployed properly.
They probably didn't test it enough.
Yeah, before. Yeah. All right, I think this is better. Okay, no, it's not. It keeps falling down. Anyway, so some of the sites are so complex, and you have too much, you've already spent a lot of time working on it, and the configuration change from time to time, or change a lot, and then you have this fragile website that you can never get to work properly. And then there's this, when you try to integrate, basically the whole integration hell doors open. Anybody have this? Situation. Nice scene, right? Okay, so so we decided that we want to change that, and we decided that we want to deliver faster, and actually increase our quality. So not only not one of these, but do both at the same time. We wanted to spend more time developing functionality for our clients, not working on bug fixing. And especially bugs that shows up only because you integrate the sites into a live environment or because you're doing some deployment. And of course, we wanted to get a happy client, and we wanted the team to stay relaxed and be happy and not always trying to do bug fixes and stress out. So how did we do it? So the first important thing that you absolutely need to do is, and this is basically trivial, you need to maintain a code repository. And there's no other way you can go around this. If your code is somewhere that where you don't trust the place where the code is, then you're basically not set up. And you need one important thing is that you need to have a branching model. And your developers need to actually understand the branching model. You need to make sure that everybody knows what to do and which piece of code gets committed to which branch. We use Git, of course, and we also found that using a visual tool, which is called GitLab, which is very similar to GitHub, but you get to install it on your own premises and just use it. It's pretty useful and pretty provides some at least you can share links of commits and so on. And by having this branching model, also you can the collaboration of the team will improve because they all want to. They all know what they are doing. There's no code that goes to live, or is submitted, without any good reason. All right. So the second important thing, and this is also very important, is automating the build. And what do we mean by build? For us, when we say that we automate the build, basically it means that the build should be able to get the code from somewhere, from a trusted place. Then you can do some checks on the code, run some tests, like unit tests or whatever. Then you use a database with proper data, and then you maybe do a couple of things like revert the features of Drupal or do things. And at the end, you need to have a working Drupal site. So that's what we call a build. Another important thing with the build is that you need also to know, understand where are you putting the build? What's the environment that the build is going to run on? So basically, you need to care about how PHP is configured, how Apache is set up, and all this stuff needs to be also part of the build. Because if you build something on one environment, it can work, on another environment, it can completely crash and break. Then we have what we've done is that we've done our daily development and integration into a lifelike environment. And this is also very important. You shouldn't be deploying or integrating into an environment that is completely different than the live, because after that you'll get into troubles. So once we automated the build, we were able to build more often. And basically what we try to do is to make the build also run the tests. And sometimes tests, or actually simple tests, are very slow, so we're not like building them always, so our build is parameterized. You can say to run the test or just to skip the test. So if we're running the build on a test server, we just run all the tests. If not, if you're trying to build it locally, then you just skip this. And after, so it, and it's also important to run your test on a clone of production. And it's important also to test your deployment procedure itself. So before you deploy on production or on the live site, you need to you can check out the whole code and bring the live database to a test server, and then you try to deploy there over and over again until you're sure that the deployment is okay, and then you can move all that and do the final step on the live site. Yeah, so that's automate deployment, and basically you need to, it's always good to be sure before you go to the live environment, you need to practice it over and over on a staging server, which is basically a clone of the live environment. Another thing here is that you, we automated all our migrations or any, it depends on the project, but if you have any migrations or any content that needs to move from one structure to another structure, you should also do this all automatically and never let anybody go to the live environment and actually do some clicks in order for some things to work, because this is basically a potential cause of issues. So yeah, our results, what we've achieved is now we are doing one-click deployment. You only need to run one script, and the site is can be both built and deployed to the live environment. We were spending like 3 hours before that, gathering the configurations, gathering, preparing, making lists, doing all sorts of manual stuff. And now it all can be done in 15 minutes, which is basically the time that it's taken. Most of the time is taken to clone the database from, if we're deploying this on staging, so we just clone the database from the live website, we sanitize it, and then we run all the deployment on a real production database. Yeah. So after that, after we've done all that, and because we were able to always test the deployments and the builds over and over again, once we say that the thing is ready or the website is ready to go live, we barely have any maintenance and or any kind of bugs that the client discovers. And which also means a lot for the team and for the levels of stress in the team. Again, a team focus shifted from bug fixing and all doing all this annoying stuff to creating really useful features. And it just feels much, much more better than to do new features and not, you know, get stuck in bug fixing. Yeah. So that was continuous integration and why you should use it. And some of the results that we achieved. Now I want to talk about some of the tools and the practices that we use and how we actually achieved that. So I'll review some of the tools for Drupal 7 because now we're building in Drupal 7. I'll mention some of the limitations and problems, and after that we'll go to Drupal 8. Here's a bunch of tools that basically I think most of the people familiar with. I mean, the first line, update hook, it's a powerful thing, but can be a bit complex. Features, anybody uses features? All right. Anybody completely happy with features? Okay. All right, features is a very great module, and it's I think it goes like to 90% of the configuration management thing, maybe 95, but it still have its limitations, and some of the limitations are, for example, you need to have exportables. Your module needs to have exportables in order to make it work with features. and basically features was built to distribute features, not to manage configuration or not to deploy such. Feature have 5 or 10 things, and now the client want to edit or make changes on the live site with a feature, and all these 5 things become always bound in the same feature. So what we do is we unlink things from feature, like we remove stuff from it, and then we can export it back, or we can just continue working with only the things that we do need to change. And this unlink functionality is available in a module called feature tools. All right, so we also use Drush, and Drush basically is the Swiss Army knife of Drupal. The important thing with Drush is that you can really do a lot of automation just by putting a couple of Drush commands into a shell script. So here are a couple of commands that we use. And so Drush can enable, disable modules and features, which is probably everybody familiar with. Put the site on maintenance or set variables, which is also very useful if you want to set a variable, then unset it during the deployment or do some more complex logic with it. A very neat feature is the synchronizing the data and sanitizing it. So you can get sync the database from production server. Sorry. And if you use this sanitize switch, it will go and basically anonymize all user data on your database. And this is basically done to prevent spamming your clients or whatever, you know, emails or that in the database you have. It just anonymize everything. You can always sync files from the production side, which we also found very important. You do need the staging site or even the development site to always look the same as the live site. Then you can evaluate code with Drush. So basically, this is also very useful. You can just write some Drupal code within after Drush EV, and then it will get executed. And in the same way, you can execute SQL queries. And of course, you can extend Drush and write just about any complex functionality or any complex PHP logic that you need. A good example here is, for example, if you need to do some migrations in your website, you can really control that very well with a custom Drush command where you go and you change some structures or move some content, and it will be part of the deploy. Yeah, so I talked about the importance of environments, and for environment scripting, or for making sure that the environment is always up to date with the code, we use a tool called SaltStack. Anybody familiar with SaltStack? No? Okay, 1, 2. So you should really check this out. It's very easy to install. And the basic idea is that it's a configuration management system that uses data files also, like it stores the configurations in YAML, and it's a remote execution system. So it's pretty much like, I think, like Puppet or Chef. You can set it up with master or masterless way. And what it does is that you can. So what we do is that when an environment is being set up or booted, it asks for its configuration from a Salt Master server that we have. And the Salt Master server basically is a centralized place to keep configurations. So we have basic stuff like make sure that Apache is on, make sure that PHP is configured, make sure that there's enough RAM for PHP, and so on. And also the salt master is smart enough to go to the Git repository and also actually check the code of the project that is being deployed now and add things on top of that. So a good example of this is some of the developers use some functionality that needs a library, like the curl library maybe. And when the developer commits the code that uses the curl library, he can also in the same project just go ahead and modify the salt configuration files. And any build that will happen after that will automatically install the library for you on the environment. So it's kind of, it has a generic configuration, and it also can go to Git and bring some project-specific configurations. Yeah, and SaltMaster can also push configurations to already running environments, so you can basically go ahead and push some new things to your production or staging environments. So in terms of infrastructure, one more thing that I want to share. We use Vagrant and CloudStack. And basically what we do is that we use Vagrant to make sure that all development happens on similar boxes. Anybody familiar with Vagrant? All right, cool. So we basically have images that we pre-built, and then the same image is used to fire up Vagrant boxes. And we use this image also on a cloud infrastructure that we built based on CloudStack, and this infrastructure basically is where we have a development integration server, we have the staging and production. So the same basic image is used. After that, as I just mentioned, the SaltMaster goes and makes sure that the environment is completely ready by checking Git if it need to install any extra stuff on the environment. And yeah, and only after that we start building Drupal on top of that. We also have Jenkins, which also checks Git and does some automated stuff on our production server, on our cloud infrastructure, like checking out the code to dev, always running tests on staging, and so on. And it gets some report and report back. Yeah, and so the infrastructure that we've built actually is quite good, and we are trying now. We're selling this, or we're providing this infrastructure as a service. So if you're interested, go and check it out. Yeah, more tools. So we use Jenkins, as I just mentioned. We're exploring with Fing. Fing can be used also to build. Right now we're building with shell scripts and Drush scripts, but Fing is probably a more powerful tool to do that. And of course, for testing, we use simple tests, and we use Selenium to do kind of a smoke tests on top of that. And the problem with simple tests is that it's pretty slow, so you won't be able to most likely won't be able to run it on your development environment or your local development. Yeah. So basically, the main limitation that we have now is configuration management with features. We get into troubles with that, and the lack of integration into external tools, which may be WF tools, yeah, module can resolve that. All right. So what about Drupal 8? What should we be watching for in Drupal 8? And of course, Drupal 8 is still a work in progress, but unsurprisingly, the most anticipated thing in Drupal 8 in terms of configuration, in terms of deployment, is the configuration management initiative, which is basically a core API it's a core API to deal with all configurations, so you don't need to rely on any exportables. It's file based, it uses YAML files, and so therefore can be versioned, so all your configuration can be put into a version control system. Yeah, the configurations are cached in the database, and by default, the configuration manager module is pretty simple and have a very, at least what you get now when you install Drupal, is a very basic workflow. So this is an example of a workflow. Again, we have kind of the same as the features. We have the database, we have an active directory and a staging directory. And both these directories actually reside in a subdirectory of files. And the subdirectory is called config, and it's followed by a hash. So what you get immediately when you install Drupal 8 is that you can basically export from the development environment. If you export your configurations, it will provide you kind of a config.tar file. You export that, and you can go ahead and immediately put it into the staging. Just unpack it and copy it into the staging subdirectory in production. And then when you're ready, you can go to the interface and just sync it, and then basically your production system will switch between the active and will sync, will accept all the new configurations. The thing that I didn't find any solution for is that once, or maybe not that convenient now, even though the documentation mentions it, is that having this hashes in the config directory will kind of make it a little bit hard to put in Git. So we have directories that are under the files, which is already kind of a not very convenient way. I mean, we don't put in our projects, we don't put the files directly in Git. We don't track the files directly in Git. But even if you do that, you'll have a directory with hashes, which may change from environment to environment, and therefore, yes?
Part of this is in the settings page, maybe
you
change this.
Yeah, maybe by default, yeah. But you will still have the hash, probably will still have the hash, because it's built into there in this for a security reason. It's not like every time, but you cannot guarantee that it will stay the same through all your environments. So one way to deal with this, maybe writing a drush command that will bring the hash, or be able to figure out the hash from Drupal and then deploy things. But so far, this is kind of it's not. It's not used yet, and therefore that is why we this is a good place to write contribution modules. Yeah. So, but that's not all with Drupal 8. We have several new APIs in Drupal 8 that will definitely help deployment. and several new modules. Features 3 is going to be written on based on the new configuration management API, and maybe it will have some configuration tracking, but at least it will use the configuration management API to package things as usual and just distribute them. There's another API which is called the state API in Drupal, and it's basically a place to store configurations or information that is not that is related to the system state. Like, for example, you can use this for build numbers of the site. You don't want to migrate or push build numbers from one or maybe not build numbers, maybe last time the cron run. There's some variables that you don't necessarily need to push from development to staging to production. All these things should stay on their environments. Another thing is Composer. So you can, this will definitely help managing dependencies and definitely help automating the build. I didn't see any examples yet related to the state API, and we're not using Composer yet, but this is something that we definitely will look at, and this should help us automate the builds. One more major thing in Drupal 8 is the shift from simple test to PHP unit. And basically this means that we can write more faster unit tests and probably benefit for test-driven development practices, because if you're building tests and they are very slow, it's not going to work for you if you're trying to do test-driven development. You need to write your test, write some code, and then always try to make your code pass this test. And we get coverage reports also with PHP unit. So to-dos for Drupal 8 is basically the next steps are we need to finalize the APIs as was mentioned today by Dries, and we need to start writing contributed modules on top of that in order to basically to make sure that the APIs are suits what we need. And we also need to take a look into integration with different external continuous integration tools. So, conclusion. I hope everybody will go and do some continuous integration. It's really important. It helped us a lot. And it's pretty easy to start. You don't need to do complex things. If you just try to automate the build as a first step, this will give you a lot of opportunities and possibilities. Then Drupal 8 is pretty good. I think it's very promising, and a lot of issues will be. It's still in progress, but a lot of issues looks like that it will be resolved with Drupal 8 with contributed modules. Using, of course, the APIs, and we all need to basically to go and experiment with all these APIs and invent new workflows for building this. So thank you very much.